An auspicious Friday of the month of Adi. We are here to listen to a wonderful disclosure to be given by Sri Murali Subramaniam ji. As a newcomer of this group, I personally do not know all the great personalities who are present here, but my pranams to them all. I am honored to be here, to be a part of this group, and to anchor this particular program. Should I start with the prayer now?
Yes, please.
I invite Janani and Kumari Meera to come and present us a beautiful Devaram.
The God who wears rings in his ears. Vide Yeriyo, the God who comes on the holy bull. Thuven Madisudi, the God who wears the bright moon on his head. Kaadudaiya Sodalai Pudipoosi, the God who smears ashes from the cremation ground. Yen Ullam Kavar Kalvan, the God who, the thief who stole my heart.
நீருடைய மலரால் பணம் சேர்த்து அருள் செய்து. The God who blessed Brahma when he prayed earlier. பீருடைய பிரமாபுரம் நேர்ந்த பெம்மா இவன் அன்றே. He is none other than the Pirman himself from பிரமாபுரம். நன்றி.
Thank you.
That was a wonderful performance by Kumari, Janani and Kumari Meera. Vishwanathan ji there?
Yeah, he's there.
Good evening.
Next is, yeah, good evening, sir. Can you, next is Subhashitam?
Yeah, today is Subhashita.
Yes, sir.
Udhyama sahasam dairyam buddhim shakti parakramaha shadete yatra vartante tatra deva sahayakrit. Strenuous and continuous efforts, courage, patience, intelligence, shakti, power, parakrama, courage, and valor. All these, wherever these six qualities are there, even the gods come to our help. Thank you. I am repeating the Subhashita. Udyama sahasam dairyam, buddhi shakti parakramaha, Shadete, Tatra Vartante, Tatra Deva Sahayakrita. Thank you.
Rathnaji, you are under mute.
Thank you for the wonderful Subhashitam, Vishwanathanji. And let's start with this one. Kural for Management. Kural for Management was started on the 5th of September last year, and today is the 48th session. The forum meets on every Friday at 7 p.m. The programs are mainly in Tamil, but once a month we do it in English for the non-Tamilian members present in this group. We have future plans of conducting the program in Hindi. The focus of the program is to promote the concepts of Thirukkural, a timeless literary work, and popularize it among young students and aspiring professionals. This forum has been engaged in bringing and bridging together the identities, ideas, and philosophies of different languages. From Tamil, Thirukkural is taken, and we try and juxtapose the ideas and concepts present in similar literature across other languages like Hindi, Sanskrit, and English. Philosophy, principles, ideas, and concepts often do not have a language barrier. What we do here is to take one Thirukkural or one Adhikaram and try to bring in similar concepts from other literatures, illustrate with examples and stories in an interesting way, and relate to the concepts with management, leadership, and governance. Apart from the sessions here, we have conducted programs called Nation First for school children. The idea behind this to bring in patriotism and to appreciate our culture. We have done a Kaviyarangam and a Karutharangam few weeks back as on a trial basis. And we are planning a 3-day Valluvar Vizha in September as we are nearing the 50th session successfully. Thirukkural is written by Thiruvalluvar, who is thought to have lived in India in the 6th century. Though some scholars assign an earlier date, even earlier date, 1st century. This particular book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, is written and published in the year 1989. Like everyone here, I am also eager to listen to Sri Subramaniam Ji, how he is going to relate the concept of Thirukkural with this management concepts present in this book. I now proceed to welcome Sri Subramaniam Ji. Sri Murali Subramaniam is a gold medalist in petrochemical technology. He has additional qualifications in operations management, financial management, and industrial engineering. After working for 42 years in companies like Procter & Gamble, Trans Electra Domestic Products, Rubber Products, Gems and Jewelry Companies, and Labino Kapoor Cottons in top management positions, he retired in 2019. He is the managing trustee of Mithur Foundation's Charitable Trust, which helps the school children in many ways. He is also the coordinator of the Thirukkural for Management Forum. I now welcome Mr. Subramaniam Ji to give his lecture.
Thank you, Rataji. Thanks a lot for your introduction. Om Kanchi Vasaya Vidmahe Santa Rupaya Dimahi Tanno Chandra Shekrendra Prajotaya Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Guru Devo Maheshwara Guru Shachat Parabrahman Tasmai Sri Kurave Namaha Akratunda Mahakaya Surya Kodi Samaprava Avignam Guru Medeva Sarva Karyeshu Sarvata Akaram Udala Yurithalam Adi Bhagavan Mudatre Ulav. Good evening, everyone. As Ratnaji pointed out, the book The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People was published in 1989. The same year, in 1989, I had the opportunity of attending a training workshop on this subject conducted by an expert who got trained directly by Mr. Stephen Covey. Over a period of time, whenever I revisited these 7 habits, I started relating this to our Thirukkural and found much more substance in Thirukkural. This session is basically to share what I could derive from Stephen Covey and Thiruvalluvar. We can easily discuss each habit for hours together, but given the time constraint, we will briefly review the crux of the habits. I may take approximately 40 to 45 minutes, kindly bear with me. Now we will talk about Stephen Richard Covey. The next slide, please. He was an American educator, author, businessman, keynote speaker. His most popular book is this book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. His other important books include, you can see there, The First Thing First, Principle-Centered Leadership, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Families, The 8th Habit, The Leader in Me. In 1996, he was named as one of the 25 most influential people in USA by Time Magazine. He was a professor at John M. Huntsman School of Business at Utah State University till his death in 2012. He lived for 80 years. Now let's look at Thiruvalluvar. Commonly known as Valluvar, a celebrated Tamil poet and a philosopher, author of Thirukkural, a collection of couplets on ethics, political, economical matters, and love. The text is considered an exceptional and widely cherished work of Tamil literature. Malai Malai Adigal gives 31 BCE as the birth year of Valluvar, whereas many other scholars infer around 500 BCE, between 400 and 500 BCE actually. Valluvar has influenced a wide range of scholars across the ethical, social, political, economical, religious, philosophical, and spiritual spheres. His brief but powerful statements on several issues are sharp, precise, and focused. They convey the meanings and messages which impact not only the thought patterns of people, but also their emotions and lifestyles. They are a delight to curious human minds of all ages and carry on an eternal value. Our forum, Kural for Management, is basically to spread the messages of Valluvar in management, leadership, good governance field to the world, as Ratnaji pointed out. Now let's go to the basics of 7 habits. Stephen Covey believed that the way we see the world is entirely based on our perception. We must change ourselves to change a situation. For that, we must be able to change our perception. That is very, very important. He felt a need for developing personal effectiveness and growing healthy relationships with other people. Covey studied 200 years of literature on the concept of success. He noticed two types of success. In earlier days, the foundation of success rested upon the character ethic, like integrity, humility, fidelity, temperance, courage, justice, patience, industry, simplicity, modesty, etc., etc. After the First World War, from 1920s, this got changed to personality ethics, like personality, public images, attitude, behavior, etc., etc. You will be surprised to see Thirukkural talking about all these characteristic ethics, like gratitude, neutrality, self-restraint, non-enviness, no backbiting, a dread of evil deeds, charity, fame, compassion, learning, wisdom, right timing, right place, justice, perseverance, fearlessness, friendship, dignity, etc., etc., in 108 chapters, that is both righteousness and the wealth, you know, under these two heads. According to Covey, it's your character that needs to be cultivated for sustainable success, not personality at all. What we are says far more than what we say or what we do. The character ethic is based on series of principles. Now let's see the 7 habits. The 7 habits are mentioned here. Be proactive, begin with the end in mind, put first thing first, think win-win, seek first to understand, then to be understood, synergize, and sharpen the saw. The habits 1, 2, 3 are focused on self-mastery, moving from dependence to independence. Whereas 4, 5, 6, these habits of 4, 5, 6 are on developing teamwork, collaboration skills, and moving from independence to interdependence. The habit 7 is focused on continuous growth and improvement, and this embodies all the other 6 habits. You can see the diagram now. This clearly shows how the movement of, you know, you go from dependence to independence and from independence to interdependence. You can easily see the private victory and the public victory, whereas the first three habits are of private victory, and the second ones are all public victory. So the next one, all these 7 habits are composed of primary principles of character upon which success and happiness are based. Real change comes from inside out. Trying to master external techniques without altering your thinking and yourself as a person will not bring fruit. The inside out approach means to start improving yourself, that is, work on your character and paradigm. Now let's get into the first habit. Habit 1, that is be proactive. If you want to be effective, you must be proactive. Reactive people say normally, there is nothing that I can do. That's just the way I am, and I can't change at all. They think the problem is out there somewhere else. That thought itself is a problem. Reactive people feel increasingly victimized and out of control. Whereas proactive people, they recognize that they have the responsibility, response and ability. That is the ability to choose how you will respond to a given stimulus or a situation. Being proactive means taking responsibility of your life. You don't blame your behavior on external factors like circumstances, etc., but own it as a part of conscious choice based on your values. The values are very important here. Reactive people are driven by feelings and emotions, whereas proactive people are driven by values. Proactivity is more than just merely taking initiative. If you want to be proactive, you must focus on the circle of influence that lies within the circle of concern. Here you can see the diagram. The outer circle shows the circle of concern, and the inner circle is the circle of influence. So proactive people, what they do is they try to expand the circle of influence, and they reduce the circle of concern. Whereas the reactive people, they try to reduce the circle of influence and then increase the circle of concern. So they blame external factors, creating negative energy, and that's reducing the influence. So this is what the difference between the proactive people and the reactive people. The manifestation of proactivity can be seen in your ability to stick to your commitments that you make to yourself and also to others. Commitment to self-improvement and personal growth are very, very important. A proactive person is very clear about his long-term goals and aligns everything to accomplish his goals. Next one. There are 4 types of planning. Reactive planning, that is past oriented. Inactive planning, which is present oriented. You know, there you don't do any damn thing. Inactive. Preactive, that is where you predict the future. And the last one is proactive planning, where you create the future. Design a desired future and then invent ways to create that future is really a proactive planning. A proactive person thinks ahead, acts ahead, and gets ahead. Now, you all must be knowing about this story. There are 2 persons, Sita and Geeta. They joined an organization at the same level, almost at the same time. After 1 year, Sita got promotion, but Geeta did not get any promotion. So Geeta developed a sense of jealousy and disgruntlement. She submitted a resignation to the boss, stating favoritism to Sita. The manager called Geeta and told her, you know, what happened, why you want to resign? She said, no, this is what is the problem. So then he told her, okay, go and find out if anyone is selling watermelons in the town. This story you might have seen in, you know, what in WhatsApp or somewhere else, Facebook, etc. Geeta came back and said, yes. Then the manager asked more questions about the price, how many are available, etc. Geeta could not give the answer. So she had to go out, she had to drive again and then find out all the answers. Simultaneously, he asked Sita the same question, whether anyone is selling watermelons in the town. She went out and came back. And then when the boss asked her the question, the same question, she said, only one person is selling watermelons. Also, she gave much more information like what is the cost, what is the selling price, what is the stock that he has got, what is the quality up to, and whether it is available immediately or not. And all those, you know, availability pattern, delivery schedule, etc., etc., etc. So after hearing all these things, Geeta also got impressed and realized the difference and decided to take back her resignation. So, friends, to be successful in life, one must be smart, observant, proactive, positive, and go beyond the call. Now we have seen what is proactiveness as per Stephen Covey. Now let's see, because the topic is we are going to compare what Stephen Covey is saying and what is it in Thirukkural. Whether Thirukkural is talking about the same thing or something better or nothing at all. So now let's see, as far as proactiveness is concerned, what is there in Kural? There are many Thirukkurals which explicitly and implicitly convey the habits. We have shown only a few here. Now I will be reading the Thirukkural and also I'll give you the meaning of that. உள்ளியதெல்லாம் உடனேதும் உள்ளத்தால் உள்ளான் வெகுளியனின். If a man never indulges anger in his heart, he will obtain whatever he has thought of. That means if you don't react, you will achieve everything. So reaction is not the solution. தினை துணையாம் குற்றம் வரினும் பனை துணையா கொள்வர் பழிதானுவர். Those who fear guilt, if they commit a fault small as a millet seed, will consider it to be as large as a palm tree. So proactive people are very, very sensitive. They take everything to the minute things and then they immediately work on that. Varumunnar kavadan vaalkai erimunnar vaithooru pola kedum. The prosperity of a person who does not timely guard against faults will perish like a straw before fire. We know how, you know, if there is a fire kept in front of straw, it catches fire very immediately and then the whole, entire straw gets, you know, burnt. So prevention is better than cure. Proactive people will take all the steps to prevent. Tan kutram nikki pirar kutram kaangirpit en kutram aagum iraiku. No fault will remain in those who has put away his own evils and looks after the evils of others. Proactive people don't blame others, they take the responsibility. That is the meaning of this Thirukkural. Edhiradhaar thaakkum arivinarkku illai adhira varuvador noy. No terrifying calamity will happen to those who foresee and guard against coming evils. If you are proactive, no calamity will happen. Eidharkku ariyadhu eindhaikkal annilaiyai seidharkku ariya seyal. If a rare opportunity occurs, when it lasts, let a man do that which is rarely to be accomplished. So proactive people make use of the right opportunity at the right time. Arindatri saigir paarku allal vinaithan sirandhan endru evar paatranru. What can only be accomplished by a man of wisdom and patient endurance. So from here we come to that proactive people have patience. Idanal இவன் முடிக்கும் என்று ஆராய்ந்து அதனை அவன் கண் விடல். Proactiveness is not just initiative. After having considered this man can accomplish this by these means, let the leader leave with him the discharge of that duty. So proactive people are delegated due to their accomplishment and they grow in the ladder. Next. உள்ளியது எய்தல் எளிது மண் மற்றும்தான் உள்ளியது உள்ள பெறின். இட் இஸ் ஈஸி ஃபார் ஒன் டு அப்டெயின் வாட் எவர் ஹி மே திங்க் ஆஃப் if he can again think of it. So proactive people are focused and hence accomplishment is very easy. So here the meaning is that proactivity, proactively one should take all the precaution. உள்ளுவதெல்லாம் உயர் உள்ளல் திங்க் பிக் வினைக்கண் வினைக்கடல் ஓம்பல் வினைக்குறை தீர்ந்தாரின் தீர்ந்தன்று உலகு ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் டோன்ட் கிவ் அப் சோ ஈஸிலி கருவியும் காலமும் செய்கையும் செய்யும் அறிவினையும் ஸோ ஹியர் வி கம் டு நோ தட் ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் பீப்புள் கேன் பிளான் ப்ராப்பர்லி அண்ட் மேக் யூஸ் ஆஃப் ஆல் தி ரிசோர்சஸ் வெரி எஃபெக்டிவ்லி தெரிதலும் தேர்ந்து செய்தலும் ஸோ எக்ஸிக்யூட் த ஜாப் இன் த பெஸ்ட் மேனர் பாசிபிள் விச் ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் பீப்புள் நார்மலி டு ஊரோரால் உற்றபின் ஒல்காமை ஸோ ரிமூவ் ஆல் தி என்ட்ரன்சஸ் ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் பீப்புள் டோன்ட் கெட் டிஸ்கரேஜ் டியூ டு செட் பேக்ஸ் ஈவன் இஃப் தெர் இஸ் எனி சொல்லுதல் யாருக்கும் எளிய அறியவாம் சொல்லிய வண்ணம் செயல் இட் இஸ் வெரி ஈஸி டு டாக் அபவுட் ஆர் சே சம்திங் பட் வெரி டிஃபிகல்ட் டு கெட் த ஜாப் டன் ஸோ ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் பீப்புள் தே மேக் திங்ஸ் ஹேப்பன் வினையான் வினையாக்கி போடல் ஸோ ஹியர் ப்ரோஆக்டிவ் பீப்புள் கம்ப்ளீட் ஒன் ஜாப் and complete another connected job also. So they start with one and then there it may be a side effect of that, so they do the second one also, the related one. Sirumaidan kutrame kuri vidum. So here not great people divulge the faults of others. So here basically you come to know this is a reactive kind of thing. So here they don't blame others. Sirumaidan kutrame kuri vidum, which I told you now. And then கருமம் செய்ய ஒருவன் கரித்தூவேன் எனும் பெருமையின் பீடு உடையது இல் ஸோ ஐ வில் நாட் சீஸ் இன் மை எஃபர்ட் தெர் இஸ் நோ ஹையர் கிரேட்னஸ் தேன் ஒன் சேயிங் ஐ வில் நாட் சீஸ் இன் மை எஃபர்ட் ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் பேசிக்கலி வாட் திருக்குறள் இஸ் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் ஆன் ப்ரோஆக்டிவ்னஸ் அண்ட் ரியாக்டிவிட்டி தெர் ஆர் மெனி மோர் குரல்ஸ் பட் தென் ஐ பிகாஸ் யூனோ ஐ ஹவ் ஆல்ரெடி டாக்ட் அபவுட் மெனி மெனி திருக்குறள்ஸ் Everything, most of the Tirukkurals are talking about this habit number one. Now let's go to habit number two. Start with clear destination in mind. That way we make sure the steps we are taking are in the right direction. So we emphasize that our self-awareness empowers us to shape our own lives. Instead of living our lives by default or based on the standards of our preference of others. So what is more important is that any decision that you take, it has to be as per your own thinking and willpower. The most effective way to begin with the end in mind is to create a personal mission statement. Most of us who have worked in various organizations, we know about the mission and then values, strategies, etc. So the mission statement should focus on what you want to be, which is based on the character, what you want to do, which is nothing but your contributions and achievements, the values on which these are based. So being a manager is about optimizing the efficiency, but being a leader is about setting the strategic vision of your organization in the first place. Asking, what are we trying to accomplish? Before goals, we must be able to identify our values, our personal values. You might have seen these vision statements, mission statements, and values in most of the balance sheet. Identify our center. Whatever is at the center of our life will be the source of our security, guidance, wisdom, and power. So it can be a spouse centered. Our life can be a spouse centered. Can be a family centered one. Money centered. Work centered. Possession centered. Pleasure centered. Friend centered. Enemy centered. Self centered. It can be anything. But the most important thing is it should be principle-centered. Identify timeless, unchanging principles. These principles give you something to hold on to during the tough time. With a principle-led life, you can adopt a clearer, more objective worldview. You might have seen recently, I read this recently somewhere. The Google, when you go out with the Google map, when you try to change the route, it never yells or condemns you when you take the wrong turn. It never says, idiot, you have taken a wrong turn. Now you have to take a long way around and it will take more time. Learn to pay attention. It never says like this. but it simply rewards you and then shows the next best way to reach your destination. Its primary aim is to reach your goal and not in making you feel bad for having made a mistake. So help in fixing the problem, do not blame others. This concept of hedgehog, everyone possibly you may be knowing, philosopher Isaiah Berlin applied this concept of hedgehog, knowing one big thing. Whereas the fox following many things but failing in many ways, in his book, or it was an essay actually in 1953, The Hedgehog and the Fox. Foxes pursue many goals at the same time, and hence their thinking is scattered and unfocused, and ultimately they achieve very, very little. Hedgehog focuses on a single overarching vision, and they mostly achieve. Jim Collins, in his 2001 book, that is Good to Great, also talks about this hedgehog concept. People who use this, who use their strengths, are happier and more confident. Now let's see what Thiruvalluvar has to say on this. Enni thuniga karumam thunindapin ennuvam enbadhu ilukku. Consider and then undertake a matter. After having undertaken it, to say we will consider is folly. So think, plan your work to reach your goal, and then do the task. Nyalam karudinum kaikudum, kalam karudhi idathar seyin. A person may accomplish conquering the world if he acts in the right time and at the right place. This is means to reach the goal. Devatan agadhenum mayithan mayivarum pulithar. Even though God represents the against, effort is bound to pay the wages of labor. Perseverance is important to reach the goal. கடை கொடுக்க man's fitting work is known by success achieved. If you are focused on reaching your goal, success is assured. எண்ணியர் எண்ணியாங்கு எய்து எண்ணியார் எண்ணியாக தெரியும். If those who have planned an undertaking possesses firmness in executing it, they will obtain what they have decided. Be firm in reaching your goals. That is the crux of that Thirukkural. Now we'll go to the next one. Put things first, thing first. We must have discipline to prioritize our day-to-day actions based on what is more important and not what is most urgent. This habit is about actually going after the goals of habit number two. Habit number three focuses on practice of self-management through independent will. We need to have the willpower to do something when we don't really want to do that. Similarly, we should have the willpower not to do something when we want to do it. We need to act according to our values rather than the desire or impulse on any moment. Having an independent will means you are capable of making decisions and acting on them. How frequently you use your independent will depends on your integrity. Your integrity depends on your values and your commitment. Habit number three concerns with prioritizing these commitments and putting the most important thing first. Hence, actions must be principle-centered, conscience-directed, on core values, able to define your key mission, able to give balance to your life, and organized either weekly or daily. So the challenge is not to manage time, but to manage ourselves. Now you can see there are four quadrants. On one side you have importance, and on the other side you have urgency. Quadrant one, quadrant two, quadrant three, quadrant four. You can see what is there in quadrant one. Crisis, persisting problems, deadline, drives, projects. Quadrant two is relationship building, recognizing the new opportunities, planning. Quadrant three is interruptions, some calls, meetings, popular activities, whereas in quadrant 4 you have trivial, busy work, time wastages and pleasure activities. We react to urgent matters. We spend our time on not important matters, that is, we neglect quadrant 2, which is very, very crucial. If you focus on quadrant 1, you know, managing crisis problems, they become bigger and bigger until it consumes us completely. This leads to stretch, burnout, etc. Quadrant 3, this leads to short-term focus, feeling out of control and broken relationships. Quadrant 4, we are leading irresponsible life, leading to getting fired from the jobs, highly dependent on others. So the quadrant 2 is the best. Effective personal management, building relationships, long-term planning, exercising, preparation for future. So if you want to focus your time in quadrant 2, you must learn to say no to other activities, even if it is very, very urgent. So what is more important is you should know how to delegate. If you focus on quadrant 2, we are thinking ahead, working on the roots, preventing crisis. This helps us to implement Pareto's principle, that is 80% of your results come from 20% of your time. So focus on relationships and results. The secondary focus is on time. Think effectiveness with people and efficiency with things. That is what Covey says. Now let's go to the quarrel related to this habit. Thoonguga thoongi sayarpala thoongarka thoongadu seyyum vinayum. Never sleep over such actions as may not be slept over. That means do not postpone important tasks. So most of the quarrels will say the same thing. Thulchi mudivu thunivaidal athunivu thalchiul thangudal teedu. Delay in execution of that resolve to act is an evil. Kalangadu kanda vinaikan thulangadu thukkam kadindu sayal. An act that has been firmly resolved on must be as firmly carried out without delay. So everywhere he says that whether important things you should never postpone. So now the next two quarrels we have already seen under proactiveness. So delegate effectively to the right person. So make use of the right opportunity when it comes to you. Now let's go to habit number 4. Now, first the three habits, as I said, these are all basically on the personal area. Now, 4, 5, 6 are basically for the team. So here, from individual, now we are moving to the society. Now, I just want to tell you at this time that next week, on 13th, we are going to have a Pattimandram. Pattimandram is a debate. That is basically on what Thiruvalluvar says, what he talks more about, you know, what he promotes. Is it an individual improvement or the society improvement? So please watch that debate also next week. And now coming back to think win-win. Create win-win situations that are mutually beneficial and satisfying to each other. This is not a technique at all. It's a philosophy of human interaction. So this win-win philosophy is, you know, it's not a real management technique. 2. Embody the mindset for win-win philosophy. Life must be seen as a cooperative and not a competition. So we have to work with others and not, you know, one versus the other. Anything less than win-win outcome goes against the pursuit of interdependence. So there are 6 paradigms which we have shown here. First one is the win-win. Win-win situation. So I win and the other person also win. You also win. Win-lose. Here I win and then you lose. So these people are prone to use, the winning man, prone to use position, power, authority, credentials, and personality to get their way. So I always want to win and then I make you to lose using my power, my authority. Lose-win. So here I lose and then you win. Quick to please and appease and seek strength from popularity and acceptance. No, I want to appease you, I want to please you, so so that, you know, purposely I lose and then I make you win, and then, you know, I become popular from your side. Lose, lose. This happens only when two thick-headed people, you know, like both of them think that, you know, they have to win. So when two persons of win-lose category, when they interact with each other, this is what happens, both lose. When two win-lose people get together, that is the stubborn, ego-invested individuals interact, finally they end up with lose-lose. Win. In this, what matters is that, you know, is that there has to be, I have to win always. I'm not bothered about whether the other person wins or loses. So here the only question is win. That's all. Now there's another one which is called win-win or no deal at all. That means either win-win or, you know, nobody should have anything, no deal at all. You know, close the deal. So the best one is win-win. Win-lose, lose-win or negative impact will have negative impact on the relationship. No deal, it pushes us to manipulate. So finally, we have to have what is the best one, that is called the win-win proposal. Now there are, for win-win, there are two factors, consideration and courage. To go for win-win, you not only have to be nice, you have to be courageous. This is what Stephen Covey says. There is a principle called abundance mentality. This abundance mentality is, that means that there is a plenty of thing available for everyone. So this means to think in terms of enough possibilities and options for everyone. Such person has a deep feeling of security and personal worth. That means when abundance mentality is there, that means everything is available for, you know, a lot of things are available for everyone. So then, you know, you get into the paradigm of win-win. Now, recently, all of us might have read the Tokyo Olympics thing, that Italy versus, you know, Qatar, that on the high jump, where both of them, that is Tamberi and Barshim, both of them ended at 2.37 meters height, and then they were kept at par with each other. When one more, given three more attempts, the same thing happened, and when one more attempt was given, Tamberi withdrew due to leg injury, allowing Barshim to get the gold. But Barshim announced his withdrawal, thereby both could share the gold. Seeing this, Tamberi ran, hugged Barshim, and then screamed, "Sportsmanship beyond religion, colors, and borders is what we have seen there." So here, this is the classic example of win-win. So interdependency creates win-win relationship. In interdependency, everyone adds to what is being created. They are give-give relationships. So codependent relationships are take-take or take-give relationships. Now let's see what Thiruvalluvar has to say. Valiyar mun tannin ninaikadan tannin meliyar mel sellumidathu. So here, this is a classic case of paradigm shift. Think how you feel before the strong, when to the feeble you do wrong. That means when you are doing something wrong to the, you know, or the feeble person, you know, at the same time you see how you are going to be in front of a strong person. Tam inburuvadu ulagin purakkandu kaamuruvar katru arindavar. The learned will long for more learning. When they see that it gives pleasure to themselves, the world also derives pleasure from it. So we feel happy when we see others are also happy. இறுதி பயப்பினும் எஞ்சாது இறைவர்க்கு உறுதி பயப்பதான் தூத்து. Fearlessly seek his sovereign's good, though it should cost him his life. That means it's basically a case of lose-win. Our soldiers are the examples. No, they save the nation at their own cost. சூழாமல் தானே முடிவு எய்தும் தம் குடியை தாழாது உணற்றுபவர்க்கு. Those who are prompt in their efforts to better others need no deliberation. Success will happen automatically. That means if you want betterment for others, it will happen automatically. So always think good. Now, as far as the abundance is concerned, there are three Thirukkural that I have seen. Poorundu neer nirandatre ulagavam perarivalan thiru. The wealth that wise and kind to make is like water that fills a lake. So here he is talking of an example of water from a lake. That means it's continuously, you know, the water is coming out. The next one, கைமாறு வேண்டா கடப்பாடு இன் தட் ஹி டாக்ஸ் அபவுட் யூனோ தி 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 ரெயின் தி கிளவுட்ஸ் தி கிளவுட்ஸ் கிவிங் ரெயின் டு அஸ் இர்ரெஸ்பெக்டிவ் ஆஃப் வாட் வி டூ நான் இந்த தேர்ட் ஒன் பயன்மரம் உள்ளூர் பழத்தற்ற ஆல்சோ ஹியர் தி வெல்த் இஸ் அவைலபிள் லைக் அ ஃப்ரூட்ஃபுல் ட்ரீ இன் த மிட்ஸ்ட் ஆஃப் அ டவுன் ஸோ நவ் லெட்ஸ் கோ டு தி நெக்ஸ்ட் ஹேபிட் ஹேபிட் நம்பர் ஃபைவ் ஸ்பீக் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் then to be understood. It's a classic case of you know how one should listen to others and then only you should talk. Before we offer advice or suggestion or suggest solutions, we must seek to deeply understand the situation and their perspective through empathic listening. This empathic listening is very, very important. We normally prescribe a solution before we diagnose the problem. We don't seek to deeply understand the problem. You have to build the skills of empathic listening on a base of character that inspires openness and trust. This is trust is what you know what Stephen Covey says. To listen empathically, paradigm shift is required. Most people listen with intent of replying but not to understand. This is what most of us do. An empathic listener can get into the frame of reference of the person speaking. By doing so, they see the world as others do and feel things the way the others feel. Empathic listening allows you to get a clearer picture of reality. So this habit means the second part of this habit is critical for win-win. So first basically you have to listen to others and understand what they are saying, and then you have to say something so that it is understood by someone else. Now if you more than in a better way, Thirukkural talks about this in a very, very nice way. Before that, let us see what is this paradigm shift. We must allow ourselves to undergo a paradigm shift to change ourselves fundamentally. So it's a story, again most of you might have read this, you know, this is again an imagination. You buy a box of cookies when you go out somewhere and put it in your traveling bag. You go and sit next to a gentleman, pull out your box, and as you do so, you notice the gentleman next to you who is sitting there, he also start watching you. He stares at you when you take the first cookie. Then he also takes one from the box and he eats. You are now at a loss for words. You know, he's just taking your cookies. Not only he takes one cookie, he alternates with you. That means you take one and he also takes another one. You think he's a crazy guy, greedy guy. Both continue to eat. When the last piece comes, he takes it out and then makes two ops. Gives one to you and then he eats the other one and then he leaves. Then you are still hungry, you buy another box from the shop, and then when you return to your seat, you notice your original box is still there unopened in your bag. So at that time, then you realize that what you had eaten was, you know, from the other man's box or other man's box and then from his traveling bag. So there's a mistake. Now what do you think of him? Do you think that he is generous, tolerant, and calm? So you have just experienced a profound paradigm shift. You are seeing things from a new point of view. So be open. Every point has got three sides: your side, my side, and the right side. To understand it better, one needs to leave his side and then, you know, not only his side, on the right side, and then he has to see what is the best thing. So maturity is correcting ourselves before trying to correct others, understanding the opinions of others from their perspective. Now if you look at the Thirukkurals are much, much better than what Stephen Covey has talked about in his book. Selvathul selvam sevichelvam achelvam selvathul ellam thalai. The wealth of wealth is the wealth of listening. The wealth out of all else. That means you cannot have a better statement to express importance of listening. Seviyunavit kelviyudaiyar aviyunavin aandrodu oppanilathu. those who enjoy listening are equal to gods. So there is nothing better than this statement at all. You know, he says, whoever enjoys listening, they are equal to gods. எனைத்தானும் நல்லவை கேட்க, let a man listen, even if it is very, very little. நுணங்கிய கேள்வியர் அல்லார், வணங்கிய வாயினர் ஆதல் அரிது. Only those with good listening powers can speak well, convincingly. So here he talks about both, you know, seek first to understand and also to be understood. கேட்டார் பிணிக்கும் தகையவாய், கேளாரும் வேட்ப மொழிவதாம் சொல். So here, speak in such a way that everyone wants to listen to you. So it is that the way you speak, everyone should be fascinated. கற்றாருள் கற்றார் எனப்படுவர், கற்றார் முன் கற்ற செலச் சொல்லுவார். So here the importance of communication using powerful, very powerful words is talked about. So he is a scholar among scholars who uses penetrating words. Now about the paradigm shift, there is a Thirukkural. Vanigam seivarku vanigam peni piravum thampol seyin. The true merchandise of merchants is to guard and do the things of others as they do by their own. That means it's a paradigm, you know, we have to see as if it is our own. Now the next habit number 6, synergize. This is a combination of the first 5 habits. The whole is much more than the sum of the parts. You know, it is not 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. It is 1 plus 1 is equal to more than 2 or 3 or 4, whatever it is. Synergy allows us to create new alternatives and open new possibilities. Win-win and also seek first to understand, these two habits help in synergizing. Then we end up with transformation. Both sides get what they want and they build relationships in the process. The real essence of synergy is valuing the differences, mental, emotional, psychological differences between people. So this is very, very important. Valuing the difference is really the synergy. Synergy is a creative process that requires vulnerability, openness, and communication. Balancing the mental, emotional, and psychological differences between a group of people, and in doing so, creating new paradigms of thought between the group members, is really the synergy. This leads to maximum creativity. Synergy is effectiveness as an interdependent reality. So the essence of synergy is really to value the differences, to respect them, to build on strengths, and to compensate for the weakness. So now let us see the Thirukkural for this. It is not explicit, but then you know implicitly we can see this. Ulagam thaliya thodpam. To secure the friendship of the great people like you all in this forum is true wisdom. எவ்வது உறைவது உலகம், உலகத்தோடு அவ்வது உறைவது அறிவு. To live as the world lives is wisdom. The world of most effective people. That is what he talks about. தம்மிற் பெரியார் தமரா ஒழுகுதல் வன்மையுள் எல்லாம் தலை. To live with great persons like you all here as cherished friends is the highest power. குணம் நாடி குற்றமும் நாடி அவற்றுள் மிக நாடி மிக்க குரல். கன்சிடர் அ பர்சன்ஸ் குட் குவாலிட்டிஸ் ஆஸ் வெல் அஸ் ஹிஸ் ஃபால்ட் அண்ட் தென் ஜட்ஜ் ஹிஸ் கேரக்டர். ஸோ ப்ரோஆக்டிவ்லி லுக் அட் அதர்ஸ் அண்ட் தென் ஹாவ் சினர்ஜி. நன்மையும் தீமையும் நாடி நலம் புரிந்த தன்மையான் ஆளப்படும். சூஸ் த குட் ஆஃப்டர் வேயிங் போத் தி ஈவில் அண்ட் குட் இன் எனி அண்டர்டேக்கிங். அழிவினவை நீக்கி ஆர்வித்து அழிவின் கண் அல்லல் உழைப்பதாம் நட்பு. Friendship is about avoiding harm and wiping away suffering in bad times by doing good. So the teamwork is working together with better understanding. இடுக்கண் களைவதாம் நட்பு. Friendship is like a helping hand. விழையார் விழைய படுப பழையார் கண் பண்பின் தலை பிரியாதவர். Even enemies will love those who have never changed in their affection to their long-standing friends. Good understanding friends and relatives are the biggest assets is what we understand from this Thirukkural. Now let's go to the last habit, that is sharpen the saw. So devote time to renew ourselves physically, spiritually, mentally, and socially. Continuous renewal allows us to synergetically increase our ability to practice the habits. Physical. what are those physical areas? Eat well, relax, rest, do exercise. These are all the things which really help you to improve your habit number one. So it increases the capacity to work and enjoy. Spiritual, meditate, communicate with the nature, immerse with in literature or immerse in music. This is to basically to practice habit number two, to provide leadership to life and commitment to value systems. Mental, expand your mind, read literature, you know, watch TV. So this basically helps to practice your habit number three. Social and emotional, to develop meaningful relationship with others. So understand others, you know, you donate when there is some, you know, calamity like corona, etc. You help others. So this is basically for the habit of 4, 5, and 6. So sharpen the saw is basically to renew ourselves physically, spiritually, mentally, and socially. The same thing, if you look at Thirukkural, the next slide. Yadanum nadamal uramal ennoruvan thandunaiyum kalladavaru. How is that one can remain without learning at all, even to his death? That is what Thiruvalluvar says. You know, how can you remain without learning at all? So learn, unlearn, and relearn till the end. Thottanai thurum manarkeni, in a sandy well, the water rises to the point of digging. So continuous renewal is a must. Atral aravarindu unga. Know the amount of digestion and then eat. You know, there is a chapter called Marundu, medicine, and there are 10 Thirukkurals. Then it talks about the medicine. So eat. There he does not say that you have to take medicine. He says the food itself is your medicine, you know, with some conditions. So eat with moderation. That is what he says. Idukkan varungal naguga, face difficult times with joy. So it is for the mental improvement. Angudiyar enbum uriyar pirarku, he who loves others will live by owing his possessions to others. So this is the social benefit. Now we have come to the end of the speech. I was lying down in my bedroom thinking about the world. Suddenly I could hear some laughing sounds. I looked out here and there. So then I could hear the fan saying, "Be cool." The ceiling said, "Aim high." Window said, "See the world." Clock said, "Every minute is precious." The mirror said, "Reflect before you act." The calendar told me, "Be up to date." The door told me, "Push hard for your goals." The carpet under my feet said, "Kneel down and pray." The toilet told me, "Flush out all your bad habits." Then I looked at the table. Thirukkural book was there. The Thirukkural book told me, "Read me for direction." So, friends, in Thirukkural, we have everything, whatever is available. I'm not saying that Thirukkural told as much better than what Stephen Covey told. Stephen Covey has expressed his feelings in a different way, but the points that he has taken are all from Thirukkural. Thirukkural talks about much more than what Stephen Covey has said. Now, from my experience, I would like to say a few things. I have tried to practice all these 7 habits after I went through the training exactly 32 years ago. So these habits, in some areas I have succeeded and in some I failed miserably. So let's talk about one by one. You know, though I have been proactive in most of my organizational areas, my wife tells me, and I also feel, that I have reacted on many occasions in my personal area. Yes. So we don't listen to our own close relatives, possibly, you know, our own ego. But if we leave aside that ego with our close relatives, you know, we should not take them for granted and then we deal with them properly. This reactivity will not come in picture. We have to get to the proactive nature and then everyone will be happy. I have enjoyed the win-win situations in my official arena. Sometimes lose win. Yes, to make the others feel good. I have done many times. The happiness of other persons makes us happy, so we lose. But then what is, for the long term, what is more important is win-win. So once, you know, I most of you may be knowing that, you know, I was the head of, you know, factories. So once one worker cried when I went to meet him, when I went to the shop floor and shook hands with him for wishing him either, I don't remember whether it is Happy Diwali or Happy New Year. He said no person of that high rank had wished him personally, that too in his workplace, for in his, you know, in his entire career, that too in front of so many people. So sometimes the small things, you know, make them happy. The empathic listening with workers, that solves most of the problems. So I used to have the open door policy. The workers feel good, or the employees feel good, if a senior person spends time with them, even if the issue is not resolved, you know, you just listen to them empathically, 50% of the problem is resolved. This forum, our forums, core group meetings are examples for synergy. The success comes only when we respect others' views. Thanks a lot for your empathic listening. If you have felt good, the credit goes to Valluvar and Stephen Covey. If it is not, I am responsible for that. Before I end, I would like to convey my sincere thanks to Mr. Sundarakrishnan, who helped me in preparing this PPT. You know, he did not sleep at all last night, and till early morning 1:30 he worked on this, and then he made this for me. Thanks a lot, Sundaram. I don't know how to express my thanks to you. So thank you very much to all of you for sympathetic listening. Thanks a lot. Over to you, Ratnaji.
Yes, wonderful speech, sir. I'm astounded now. And after listening to you, and since I have not read this book before, I want to quote a Thirukkural. Are you able to hear? Hello?
Yeah.
Yes,
please.
Arangindri vattadi atre, nirambiya noolindri koti kolal. I just remembered this Thirukkural, the meaning of which is, to speak in an assembly of the learned without fullness of knowledge is like playing a chess on board without squares. So I feel like that right now. Quite an interesting speech. I'm not a management person. I'm a homemaker. And I have not, as I told you, I have not read this book before, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. But you have stirred an interest in me, sir, to read this book now. So, and you have taken us through a beautiful journey in a very efficient and a smooth way through this book. And I really appreciate it. And I really enjoyed, I am a very reactive person in personal life. So I will try to be proactive from now. And the thing is, we'll start focusing on being proactive, and I will also follow all the 7 habits, because we have a proverb in Tamil. So the habit is, which is formed, is very, it is not easy to get rid of all the bad habits from you. It is not easy. So we will try to focus on how to improve the habits which are imbibed in us, or we have cultivated throughout on our life journey. It's a very wonderful speech. And I will end this with a Thirukkural. Ulagam thaya, how to change your habits, and how to effectively be successful is ulagam thadiya totpam malardalum koombalum illa tarivu. Neengal sonnadhu da adu. To secure the friendship of the great people is true wisdom. So I am here in this wonderful forum, which would help me to sharpen the saw, that is my brain. And I think this program is a wonderful program, and you have beautifully you have taken us through Thirukkural and the book, and we are open for discussions. Mrs. Srimati Lata Ramachandran there?
Yes, yes.
Yes, Lata ma'am is a management education expert. Ma'am, would you like to say something on this?
Yeah, of course. First, let me give the credit, thank Subramaniam sir. He has presented it so well. My God, I think he has covered almost all points, like, and he has related with Kural so well. My God, really, sir, you have done a great job and great presentation indeed. Probably you have covered all the points. So probably I may give some of my points. Maybe I don't have hold on Kural, but I can very well take the perspectives from my understanding of management and what I had been doing for so many years. Like a few things I can relate to, which may give some kind of clarity or understanding to others, make it more practical. So one thing, first one habit which has been mentioned is be proactive. When we talk about proactiveness, one thing which comes to my mind is internal locus of control of an individual. The all seven habits, it talks about individuals' behavior, group, individual in a group, and organization as a whole. So this is what it covers, like. So when you are proactive or you have to be proactive, then it talks about the internal locus of control. And internal locus of control is nothing but you have to control your feelings, your thinking about the environment surrounding you. You cannot blame the environment for what has happened to you. So that is what is internal locus of control and being proactive to the situation. Don't react, don't revolutionize. You can have an evolutionary approach towards anything, towards the environment or towards the situation. And begin with end in the mind. See, whatever roles we are performing, we have to do justice to those roles. Then only we can achieve the end or the objectives. Madam said she is a homemaker, but as a homemaker also you have certain roles which you have to do justice. And if you are a working person, you have multiplicity of roles, correct? You are a corporate person, you are a working person in the organization, you may be in a superior's position, leadership position, you also may be a subordinate, you may be a colleague, and at home, you are a homemaker, you are a mother, you are a wife, you are playing, you are a daughter-in-law. You have so many roles to perform, and each role has to be justified. And if you don't justify, then probably it results in conflict. And probably in those conflicting situations also, we react. So it says that we should be proactive even in those situations. We have to justify the roles and make it the maximum, optimize on our roles, which will be beneficial to everyone. And vision and mission statement, every organization or at home also, we have a vision statement. We have certain role behavior, how we have to behave in the family, how we have to behave with our relatives. Same in the organization, how we have to behave with our colleagues, with the superior, with the organization as a whole. For achieving the vision or the dream of the organization or the dream of the family, That is what my understanding is, and that gives you the self-awareness, how much you know about yourself and how much you can control your feelings and you do justice. Put first things first, priorities, correct? Setting the priorities. Definitely, every time we cannot be pleasing or appeasing others. We have to take a stand at certain situations. At home also, we have situations occur when we have to actually take a stand. We cannot make others happy all the time. Sometimes people get displeased, but to take control of the situation, we have to behave in that fashion. Probably for bringing discipline, for bringing code of conduct, our behavior is expected to be little strong at that moment. Same applies to the organization also. And fourth thing, it talks about win-win situation. When we talk about win-win situation, probably I would also tell you people that if you can read about transactional analysis by Eric Byrne, he talks about I'm okay, you are okay situations. See, when we consider ourselves okay and we consider others also okay, I am okay, you are okay, then the situation is very balanced. If you think I am okay, other person is not okay, then you are an egoistic person. You don't want to listen to others. Correct? And when you say I am not okay, other person is okay, means you don't have confidence in yourself. You feel that you are a submissive person. You should not be a submissive person. You have to be an assertive person. You should not be an aggressive person. You have to be an assertive person. Assertive personality, which is what talks about the win-win situation, and be accommodative with the situations in life and go in for negotiations which are for win-win, whether it is at home or whether it is in the organization. And it also builds the interpersonal relationship, very strong interpersonal relationships. Okay. And then we talk about seek first to understand and then to be understood. Empathetic communication. Listen to others. Put yourself in other person's shoe, how he feels, and behave accordingly. In the organization, definitely we have grievance handling procedures, which talks about resolving the grievances of the employees. An employee may be an indisciplined person. He may be coming late to the job. He may be remaining absent for so many days without any notice, but still give him the chance to explain his perspective or tell his perspective rather taking any kind of harsh decisions on him. So that talks about empathetic consideration. Okay. But at the same time, when you have to be strong in your thing, one has to be a authoritative leader also. All the time, people-oriented thing will not help, or empathy-oriented will not help. One has to be transactional also instead of empathetic. So keep a balance, make it proper. Synergize. See, about the synergistic attitude, nowadays organizations talk about synergizing only. We talk about only cooperate and collaborate. Then only we can progress. Of course, organizations, multinationals, it all talks about collaborations and getting into agreements and all those things. One very specific thing which comes nowadays, or which is the recent phenomena, is organizations or the society, it talks about diversity management. Accept the person as he is with his shortcomings and limitations. We have seen, we have now started, we have accepting the transgenders in the society. We are making the organizations disabled friendly. We are giving more representation for women in the organization, in the leadership roles. Probably these are all some of the very encouraging aspects which talks about the diversity management in the organization, which is possible only through synergizing. And then sharp, this is all about the group and the interpersonal skills. And then the last one, which talks about sharpen the saw, which talks about there has to be continual learning. Organizations or individuals or anybody for that matter, there has to be a continual learning, lifelong learning. Any time, any stage of your life, you can start something new to learn. And I didn't have any hold on Kural, and also my knowledge about Tamil is limited, but still I have developed some interest to learn Kural and somewhere to apply to my knowledge of management, what I have gathered over the period of time. So learning never stops. It's continual and it is throughout our life. So organizations, they emphasize on continual learning, and also we should emphasize in our families also continual learning. Make the children, make the members always learn new things, innovate, give them the freedom, independence. So these are some of the understanding which I wanted to put. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lata. Thank you very much. One second. Is Srinivasanji there?
Hello. Can I say something?
Yes, yes, sir. Please.
Yeah, I just want to share this. This is an excellent, this is my first experience how Thirukkural is related to Stephen Covey. I would say it's very well done, very well articulated. My only concern, I briefly browse through the participants. Most of them are not the young people. The team should approach this so that we maybe rephrase the way you present to attract younger generation, because the young ones should understand this more effectively, because we have the experience. Whatever you say, we can immediately link up to the experience that we had in our organization and family. So we see, oh, this is where I should have acted this way. But I think the message here is more relevant, more important to the younger generation, whose challenges are much more heavier than what we went through, those in the 50s and 60s. So I once again want to thank you for the excellent speech and the presentation. And it's a good one, but the point is it has to reach our younger generation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks a lot, sir. We will do that. We also have programs with students, so we will try to do that. Thank you very much. Yes, Ratna ji.
Yeah.
So kindly introduce yourself.
Is it addressed to me?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah, Hari Om. This is Srinivasan. I actually was planning to speak in Tamil, but now I realize this whole thing is in English, so let me switch to English. Not that I'm a good speaker in Tamil, neither in English. I will start with a small personal note. I was very happy that Mr. Subramaniam, actually he is Subbu to me. I never known him as Subramaniam. He was my colleague in my very first job. When I joined Procter & Gamble way back in 83 as a young management trainee, he was my planning manager. And you know, planning and purchasing are typically functions which are like Tamil we say Kiri and Pambar, Mongoose and Snake. But I was very surprised and very pleasantly surprised and happy that Subbu was so nice to me. He used to cover up all my mistakes and he never used to expose whatever failures be from purchasing. Because in purchasing, you depend on external suppliers and do a lot of things which don't go exactly as you plan, as Subbu planned those days. But he used to be very empathetic. He used to hear me rather than make me hear him. Now I realize where it was all coming from. I guess he told me that he underwent this program, Stephen Covey, before I even joined the company. Yeah. Now coming to the subject, I will not speak long. It'll be more like a tweet. I was very happy when the subject Subbu was speaking, Mr. Dhoni was speaking, was on Stephen Covey's book. I am not a well-read person, and particularly I am not a fan of management books. For one, I never used to understand or I used to relate to them. But there are two books which I really found very impressive. When I say I found impressive, I'm not trying to be judgmental about these books, but I could relate to them. I think the books we like are the ones we can relate to. One of them is Wooden on Leadership. It's by an ex basketball coach, John Wooden. He wrote a book on leadership. What appealed to me in that book was it was about not like a business-like approach to leadership, but it was about character. And he strongly recommends efforts. He does not recommend, he strongly speaks against competing against. He says you do better than what you did yesterday. Compete against yourself, your own standards you set, and advises you not to get into a rat race. Now, if it sounds very similar to our Bhagavad Gita, it's not a surprise to me, because I think that's why it really appealed to me. So it sort of says that you make your effort and don't have high expectations of results. And specifically, he says at several occasions, results are not in your hands. Okay. Now, coming to Stephen Covey, this is the second book I loved in my working days. Unlike other many of the other management articles and books, this is not about management by objective. It doesn't talk about some financial or organizational goals. It starts from principles. I think we've all gone through what Subbu has explained. He talks about a principle-centered approach, and that is something, again, I'll just read a couple of lines from the book. He says, principles are eternal. Principles don't die. They aren't here one day and gone next. They can't be destroyed by fire, earthquake, or theft. Now, if this doesn't sound like something from Bhagavad Gita, I don't know what else can sound like. So basically, I think he has been inspired by maybe even Tirukural, but he's been inspired definitely by Indian wisdom. So it is the principles-based leadership, principle-based organizational behavior, which he roots for. I think Subbu had an excellent job of linking Tirukural with Stephen Covey, and he did a wonderful job. But what impressed me was, see, every speaker at the end of the day, at the end of his speech, one thing he wants is for the audience to take back something home, not just to be heard and forget it. I think one thing, a big takeaway for me today was the way he, in the concluding part, he mentioned what he learned from very mundane objects in the room. He talked about the ceiling telling him to reach the high, windows telling him to open the mind, every simple objects. And I think that is something which really was an eye-opener for me, that you don't need to look for only books and gurus. Even ordinary objects around you can teach you and can inspire you a lot. Thank you, Subhut. It was a wonderful evening. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very good discussion. And is Sri Harsha Bhatt there?
Yes, Ratnaji, Dr. Bhatt is here. And okay. I would also request on your behalf,
yes,
Dr. Bhatt, yes, to speak a few words.
Yes.
I would like to inform the people who have gathered here that Dr. Bhatt, Sri Harsha Bhatt, is the director of HR department of NITI University in Mangalore. And he has specifically requested to join today's program after seeing the link with somebody else. So welcome, Dr. Bhatt, to our group. And please, we would like to hear you say a few words.
Welcome, sir.
Hey, good evening, everybody. My name is Sri Harsha. You can call me Sri. I'm thankful to one of my senior colleagues who is part of this group, who very generously recommended me and thought I deserve to be part of this group. And I'm primarily.
Sir, can you keep your video on? We would like to see you.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I'm in a very poor signal area actually today, so I was trying to save my bandwidth for the audio to listen to you, sir. One of my senior colleagues is part of this group. He has been telling me about this.
So you can switch off the video now.
All right.
You'll get better this thing networking.
All right. Thank you so much. So I'm primarily a HR person who has spent about 2 decades in the industry in India and outside the country. And now I'm part of an academic group wherein I lead a very specific program for the BFSI segment. So I'm glad, I'm sure I'll be able to contribute a bit after learning a lot from the senior people here. And, thank you, madam, for introducing me and letting me talk.
So we would like to hear your views on today's topic.
I mean, I'll tell you, I attended COVID certification program about a decade ago, not a decade, almost 15 years ago in the US. But the perspective that I got from Subramanian sir's illustration was very different. And I mean, no doubt today that, you know, COVID has certainly drawn inspiration from the Indian brains, for sure. There's no doubt about it. And Subramanian sir, I never thought of relating these two, you know, would make so much of impact or make me feel so great that I'm an Indian, of course, you know. And I'm sure, you know, I'll be able to learn a lot from these sessions going forward. And Subramanian sir, thank you so much. It was so wonderful listening to you. And it gave me a very lot of different perspective, you know. I must admit that once again. Thank you so much. Thank you. And I would certainly be part of these programs going forward.
Sir Stephen Covey, he says in his book that he had gone through literatures of the past 200 years. But he never said that he has seen or he has researched any of the Indian books. Possibly he might have, he might have gone through Tirukural, he might have gone through Bhagavad Gita, we don't know, but then he has not mentioned any of those things here. So we also have a feeling the way he has written the entire book on characteristic ethic based. So certainly, you know, it implicitly says that he might have got the clues from Tirukural, Bhagavad Gita, or any other, you know, Indian literature. We are not sure. Thank you. Thanks a lot for your comments.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Anyone else would like to give your comment?
Ratna ji.
Of course, please. I am here to express my views. Can I?
Yes, please. Yeah, yeah.
In fact, what I wanted to convey is almost conveyed by Lata ji with a broader view on today's talk. But I want to say something. There is a saying in our language, Tottil Padakkam Sudugadu Mattum. It talks about a habit. We all know that. What is a habit? Even if you remove H, a bit is there. Remove A, bit is there. Even remove B, it is there. This is what a habit talks about it. And in fact, one other thing, we all try to follow the Westerns as if they have identified or, they have experienced or they have proved something which is not in our Indian culture. It is not so. Even Tolstoy wrote a letter to Gandhiji. It's about Tirukural. He taught Ahimsa to Gandhiji, and that is the basis for his Satyagraha in our freedom fight movement. This is what the Western looks about our literary works. In fact, in today's talk, Muraliji has covered almost out of 130 couplets, even you could say that all he has touched it. I can't say, I don't want to count it in the numbers, but there are certain things which see. Tirukural mainly talks about personal ethics. If an individual, if you correct yourself, the society gets corrected automatically. That's what the Valluvar says. Even, when he structure the basis for this, he mainly concentrated on individuals. In fact, it is a very good, an excellent portrait of human ethics, which has been depicted by today's talk. The perception might vary, but the ends are same only. Thank you. Thanks for this opportunity. Over to Ratna.
Beautiful, sir. Beautiful, beautiful. And
Ratna ji, I would like to add just a small little.
Yes, please.
In this. See, today's topic is really wonderful, and it's given an opportunity to many people to ponder over these aspects. So, as an ex-banker and as a trainer, I would like to say that I was never very much impressed with foreign authors. I always looked for Indian authors to convey a few messages, whether it's motivation or communication or time management or leadership qualities. After retirement, I found all these things in one single book, and that is Tirukural. Tiruvalluvar has covered almost all the areas of management aspects, not just for individuals, but for the country as a whole. And when we talk of Stephen Covey, yes, he has told a lot about how effective a person can be in his job, in his profession, and maybe personal life also. Just for the information of all people, Stephen Covey, his grandfather was a preacher in the church, and he learnt a lot from his grandfather, and he also took up for a while preaching in the church. And while doing that preaching, he learnt many aspects of different countries and their religion. But many of the foreign authors will never admit that they have learnt anything from India, because for them, India was not a country to be looked upon or to tell very proudly. But today, we people in India, we know it, and we are bringing it out to the forefront. There is a little difference between being effective, an effective employee, and an efficient employee. Efficiency and effectiveness. Effective, you can become effective by reading all the rule books, your log books, your manuals. You can do very well in your job and rise to the top. That's possible. But to become an efficient person, a person in toto, in all aspects, there Tirukural gives us a lot of insight. How you can outshine other people by following certain rules and regulations, not just rules and regulations, even other nuances of life for a country and for the individual. I just want to give one small example. When you go out of the way and do a little more, when Subramanyam ji was talking about synergy, empathy, and more of these aspects, I remember a very wonderful incident which I happened to read very recently. It has happened. See, I'm living in Pune and it has been raining a lot here of late. Since almost 1 month, it has been raining. But it is worse in the Konkan area, the coastal area. It's been simply pouring and pouring. And in the last fortnight, there were floods. In one such place called Chiplun, it was raining so heavily, the whole night it has been raining. And the place got flooded. And there was waterlogging everywhere in the city up to knee level. And the water had entered many buildings which were in the low-lying areas. One particular person who was the boss of the bus depot, the state bus depot, he woke up at around 3 a.m. in the morning, early morning, and he noticed that water had entered his own house and there was so much of waterlogging everywhere. Immediately, he phoned a few of his colleagues and he took the keys of his office and he told another person who had one more key, because there were two keys for dual control. Seven of them left their houses at 3:45 a.m. in the pitch dark, pouring rain. They went to the office, the bus depot office. They went, opened the doors, went inside. There was already water inside. But what they managed to do was take out from the cupboards, which were again half filled with water. They took out 9 laptops and there were 2 more laptops in another place which were not in use, but they took out those also. So 11 laptops they took out from inside the cupboards, and there was a cash box having 9 lakhs cash. That also they took out, and then they came out from the office and went out, and they thought that they could keep all this safely with them by sitting inside a bus. But when they went to a bus nearby, they saw that the bus also was filled with water, more than the seat level. So what they did was they climbed up on top of the bus and they sat on top of the bus on the rooftop. And they sat there for 7 to 8 hours. And they phoned the police department and told them what they had done. And around 10:30, 11 o'clock, the police people came when the water level receded a little bit, because they brought a heavy truck, a high level truck, which where the water may not enter the engine. And to be on the safe side, they brought 2 trucks, that in case one truck fails, another truck will help them to bring them. Then they helped all these people come out from the rooftop. They took them to the police station, gave them hot tea and bread and bun and toast and everything. And then they were all safely escorted back to their house. For 7 hours, if a public servant does this only to protect the public property, you can imagine the loyalty which is there in the mind of that particular person. This is not taught in any of the motivation or leadership or personal efficiency traits in any foreign author book. This is part of our Indian culture, where we do things for protecting our, not just our own property, but for the property of the public. This was their culture, which they took it upon themselves. Nobody thrust it on them. Nobody told them, please do this. But they took it upon themselves to do this work. This has been praised all over in entire Maharashtra by the authorities concerned. And they have been recognized. It has come in the newspapers, maybe a small news, but it has come, and they deserve much more praise. So this is efficiency against effectiveness. And this is what I would like to tell, that if you read Tirukural chapter 74, he gives you 10 different kural on how a country should be, how the country's people should be, and how the country's people should work to protect the property of the country. I think Tiruvalluvar has had an insight into all these things, and he has thought of the future and given instructions and different guidelines as to how we can function efficiently and how we can outshine everybody. If today we follow these Kural, all these, whatever Tirukural, I wouldn't say rules and regulations, I wouldn't say dictates. They are not dictates, they are not rules and regulations, they are not forced upon anybody. But if we voluntarily accept these things and follow in our day-to-day life, I think we can rise to a very great level and we can take our country's name to a very great height. Thank you very much.
Oh, you have summed it up so well, G. Thank you so much. And now I call Mr. Kavinga Ramakrishnan for giving the vote of thanks.
Before that, Rataji, before that, let's hear from Raviji about his views. Raviji.
Yes, please.
I've been, I just joined. Thanks. The word is beyond the call of duty. Doing things which are right, though it is not in the register book or something. So there are innumerable examples of Indian history, both ancient, medieval, or modern history, where people have shown such great courage, sometimes even at the risk of their own lives. Recently, I read in Nagpur a person who had his, because of a corona, he wanted. He had it, but he came to know that he was a very old man. So he saw that young couple with small children. One of them, he is in need of oxygen cylinder. Oxygen was in scarcity. He told the authorities that I don't mind dying because I have enjoyed my life enough. Let me go home, but give my oxygen cylinder to that person whose children are very small. I think many of you know that. Similarly, some years
Raviji, we can't hear you. I think there is issue.
Ratnaji, we can conclude.
Some issues.
He is having
can you call Mr. Ramakrishnanji to vote of thanks?
Yeah, sure. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I, on my own behalf, and on behalf of the group Kural for Management, standing in front of you to express my sincere thanks and gratitude for making this evening program a grand success. God, the Almighty, He is the one guiding us on the righteous path to live and perform our dharma. I would like to thank the God first for giving us an opportunity, giving every one of us this opportunity individually and collectively to continuously deliver this type of program for the last 48 weeks and still to move on for a better society to come. My pranams and thanks to Bharat Mata for nurturing every one of us with the heritage, culture, and values that we all have inherited. The main pillar, Pride of Bharat Heritage, Sri Ravi Kumar Ji, we thank you very much for being with us and giving us your speech. Though we could not hear you fully, we can understand what you are given a lot of strength for all of us from where we were and where we are today, and where we are to move in future. The foundation has to be strong for anything. And the foundation for this is none other than Sri Murali Subramaniam Ji. He picks up a theme and topic every week. He coordinates with the people and resources at different longitudes and latitudes across the globe. I really wonder how you are so young, energetic, and getting so much of time to get in touch with everyone and to deliver such a beautiful and excellent programs for the society to learn from. And today, the foundation, you are not only foundation, you are the main speaker as well. And Murali Subramaniam ji, MS Subramaniam ji, we all know MS stands for devotion. MS stands for dedication. You are the live example for the topic which you have taken, the 7 habits of highly effective people. The diction, the direction, and the conviction with which you delivered has been a learning learning for all of us, and especially for me personally. Thank you very much, sir. And you have touched upon the character ethics, dependence to independence, and to interdependence, and continuous growth and development. And you have set the platform for creating the future. Let's not talk only about the past and present. Let us use the past strengths and the present support to create a better future and effective future. We thank you very much, sir. And let's still continue. Who are all the support for today's program? The 2 sweet little cute angels who sang Tevaram. Not only Tevaram, not only singing, but the beautiful explanation which they give. And that's amazing. Such a little age, the children taught. And I would like to thank both Janani and Meera, and also the parents and the guru who taught them in this Aindil Vilayadada Aimbadil Vilayuma Indra Solra Mari. Like that, at this young age, this has been taught to them, and I'm sure they will be the future leaders. Vishwanathan ji, I also thank you very much. Aptly you have chosen for the topic. The topic which MS was going to give was 7 habits, and you gave Subhashitam for the 6 qualities. Thank you very much. And how the program was coordinated. Such a highly knowledged homemaker. I repeat, such a highly knowledged and homemaker. And very, should I use efficient or effective? I would take the clue from Mallika ji, an efficient knowledge homemaker, Ratna Venkat ji. Thank you very much. You have outperformed. Thank you very much. And after the main speech, it's like desserts. After the main course, there is a dessert. Yes, Mrs. Lalita Ramachandran ji, you impressed us with the importance of and gave a very different value dimensions with the behavior focus, not only for individuals and also as a group and in family. And you also taught us neither to be aggressive, not to be submissive, but to be assertive. Thank you very much. Ravi ji also gave some suggestion for improvement. Thank you very much for the suggestions. Every suggestion is a valuable suggestion. Yepporul yar yar vai kepinum apporul meipporul kanbad arivu. Thank you very much, sir. We still look forward more suggestions for improvement. Sanji, I am very happy to know that you have worked with Ms. Murali Subramaniam ji. And thank you very much for your inputs and live examples that you have given. Thank you very much. And also the books which you have quoted, that will definitely improve our value in life. Coming in, Rejami, I know him as Sundar. And you gave the essence of what Murali Subramanian spoke in style. And we have been listening to you every week. And this time also, you exactly picked up the essence and then gave to us. Thank you very much. Mallika ji, I really admire you. Although I have not met you in person, I have not interacted with you. Thank you very much. And you today gave a live example of how the Indian culture is much more superior and way of life. And you also taught us the established superiority over the Western literature. Thank you very much, ji. Sundar Krishna, he for the presentation of the and I'm not sure he's there on the scene or not, but still I would like to give a thanks, my sincere thanks to him. And Dr. Shri Harsha Babaji, HR Director of NITI University. Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And we look forward to you adding values to our lives, in turn add values to the people whom we are interacting with in the day to day. Thank you, sir. There are also many people whom I have seen and I have not seen. I interacted, I have not interacted. They are on the screen, off the screen. They are at home. They are either occupied or have different priorities. I take this opportunity to thank every one of you. If I miss any name, please forgive me. I thank my gratitude to everyone for giving this opportunity. Not only express my gratitude, but also to be a part of this group. Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
And thank you, Sri Ramakrishnan ji, for rendering a wonderful vote of thanks. And now, Mallika ji, are you there?
Yes, yes, I'm there.
Can you please do the mantra?
Yes. Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchit dukha bhag bhavet. Om shanti shanti shanti.
Thank you very much, everyone. Well presented, Ratna ji.
Thank you,
Mallika ji. You can end the recording now.
Ravi ji, you are the host now. Please stop the recording.